Hello, and welcome to Keep the Channel Open, a podcast featuring conversations with artists, writers, and curators. My name is Mike Sakasagawa, and this is episode 59. Today's guest is Justina Botta. Hey there, folks. So it's Valentine's Day this week, and I sort of feel like I ought to do something topical for today's intro, you know, something about relationships or romance or something. But what's actually on my mind today has nothing to do with that. So I figure, what the hey, let's just go with it. So what's on my mind today is that I was thinking about this book I read recently, Weike Wang's novel Chemistry, which I can't remember which one of my friends said this, but the first I'd heard about it was when one of them recommended it as being like Jenny Offill's Department of Speculation, but with more science and Asian Americanness, which I thought, wow, that is a very specific comparison. And so I'd have to check it out. I loved Department of Speculation when I read it a few years ago. Turned out to be quite an apt comparison as well, I thought. Anyway, what came up for me as I read Chemistry was to think about the idea of autobiographical fiction. And that's a subject that I've written about a few times on my blog, and last year I talked with Alexander Chi about it on this show. That was episode 50. Basically, the question is, one, why do people always assume that if the protagonist of a novel has something in common with the author? In this case, both the narrator of Chemistry and Wang herself are Harvard-educated PhDs, both have a background in chemistry, both of them are Chinese-American, and between all that and the fact that the book is told in the first person, it seems like there are a fair number of readers out there who want to know whether the book is autobiographical or how much is quote-unquote real and how much is made up, you know, at least based on looking at some reader blogs and Goodread reviews and that kind of thing. So that's question one. And question two is, why does it matter in the first place? And I think there's definitely a gendered part of this, or at least that's my impression, that women get asked this kind of thing more often than men do when they write a book. But then, you know, obviously men do get asked this as well, since that is a question that Alexander Chi gets all the time. And I remember when I talked with him, he expressed some frustration with that question, or at least that he had initially had some frustration with it. He said something like, the question he wanted to ask was, would you believe me more if I told you, or would you believe me less? And, you know, I do think that this question is, on the face of it, kind of irrelevant, because really what matters is whether or not the book is good, right? Like, you can connect with the fictional story and fictional characters, no problem. It just has to be good. So I think that there's something intrusive about the question and something kind of almost condescending in some cases. Like, at least in some cases, especially when it's aimed at women, the way that the question functions is sort of to take away from the accomplishment of the novel. But I think that in another way, what that question is really doing is trying to create, or at least locate, some kind of relationship between the reader and the book, or maybe between the reader and the author. You know, like, something I'm always saying is that I love it when a piece of art makes me feel seen and makes me feel less alone. And like I said, that connection doesn't require factualness. It just requires that the work be done properly. But I think maybe what that means is that in order for the work to be good, for it to properly represent that aspect that you're connecting with, the author has to understand that thing, whether or not they lived it. And I think what people want to say is something like, you understand me, and I want to be friends with you. Or maybe not literally, but it's done out of a desire for a relationship. And I do think that that can be very intrusive, especially when it's done in a way that doesn't take boundaries into account. But I also can't completely dismiss it, because, well, I mean, who hasn't read something amazing and felt like they wanted to be friends with the person who wrote it? You know? And I think that in some way, that reading does form a relationship between the reader and something, and it's no less real for being one-directional and narrow, you know, and probably narrower than it might feel. Where it gets problematic is when people don't respect boundaries, and maybe asking the questions about is this real is inherently pushing up against or even past those boundaries. So I guess what I'm saying is that I get where it comes from, even if I can say, hey, maybe let's ask different questions. But as always, I'd love to hear from you all. You can tweet at me at Channel Open Pod and let me know what you think. On to today's conversation, Justina Bodak is the guest today. Justina is an artist and photographer based in Philadelphia. Her recent work, which you will hear a lot more about in the conversation, examines the iconography of the masculine history of art in relation to her work as a female artist. Her work has been exhibited in numerous solo and group exhibitions, both nationally and internationally, including at the James A. Michener Museum, Fotografia Festival di Roma, the Griffin Museum, Catherine Edelman Gallery, the Australian Center for Photography, and Art Wonderland Space in Copenhagen. Now, I first encountered Justina's work, as I have with so many of the artists I've talked to on this show, at the Medium Festival of Photography, where she gave a presentation about her work as the she was the second site lecturer for 2017. What I loved about her work and her presentation was the way that she talked about using appropriation as a means of interrogating and subverting masculine dominance and power dynamics, both in the context of art history and history in general, and also how she challenges our conventional notions of masculinity and how masculinity works in our culture. And it was all pretty exciting stuff, and as highly relevant as it felt at the time, back in October, it's certainly become even more so now as things like the Me Too movement have really pushed the conversation about gender and power much more to the forefront of our national consciousness. So all that is just to say that I'm very pleased to bring you this conversation, because this is a topic that matters to me a great deal. So if you would like to see Justina's work in person, there are a few opportunities right now. The first is in Syracuse, New York at Lightwork. She has a solo exhibition of her Land of Epic Battles series, which we talked about extensively in our conversation. That show opened January 16th, and it runs through March 2nd. And then also Justina has work in a group show entitled A Survey of Color Photography from Its Prehistory to the Present Day, which is at Haverford College in Haverford, Pennsylvania, in the Atrium Gallery at the Marshall Fine Arts Center. That one opened February 2nd and runs through April 29th. And there are links for both of those in the show notes. So if you will be in either of those areas, please do check them out. The Lightwork Show also has an exhibition catalog available for purchase, which is just $12, or you can also get a signed copy for $25. And there's a link in the show notes for that as well. All right, so let's get started. As always, if you'd like to join in the conversation, you can use the hashtag ChannelOpenPod on Twitter. And now here's my conversation with Justina Bodak. So I was really interested. I saw your lecture, of course, at the Medium Festival this past year, and I was really interested in the work that you showed. One of the things that you talked about in your presentation, and I've seen this come up in some other interviews that you've done, and artist statements, that you're very interested in masculine iconography. Mm-hmm. And in injecting yourself into masculine spaces in your practice, in your art practice. And I thought that was a really interesting and very sort of relevant idea. So you presented four bodies of work at Medium, and I was just wondering if it would be okay with you if we just sort of spend some time talking about those. Would that
be great? I think it's good to talk about them, because I think my practice is a research-based practice. And while there's a lot of people who tend to work with certain ideas aesthetically, or there's certain visuals that they're just attracted to, and they're sort of working with that, and so their work tends to look very cohesive, my work visually tends to vary quite a bit. And so I think a lot of times people have questions in terms of how the bodies of work link together. So I think it's good to talk about all of them, because there is what I see very much a single thread that kind of unites all the bodies of work. It's a certain idea that I'm trying to get at, and I'm just trying, the visuals are a kind of a different technique or different approach to trying to get at the same questions. So I think it's really important to know the bodies of work to get a sense of what I'm getting at as an artist.
Yeah, I definitely saw a through line with all four of these bodies of work. But, I'm interested in that phrase that you just used, research-based. I was wondering, can you sort of describe what you mean by that a little bit?
Yeah, so I think, you know, there's different artists produce work with different means. You know, some are materials, very materials-driven. Some are kind of they have a very emotional response to their work, or working from an emotional space or intuitive space. My work tends to involve a lot of kind of research, whether it be in art history. There's also an archaeological or anthropological component to a lot of my work, because I'm oftentimes using appropriated imagery, or even when I'm not using appropriated imagery, I'm still thinking about art history and how my work kind of ties back to images that are already out there. And so there's just a lot of kind of research that goes into making the work and understanding the context of the images that I'm making and how they fit into the broader context of images, both culturally, socially, and in terms of art. And so the meaning is kind of comes out of those three intersections. And I think that's why I'm interested in photography as a medium, because photography sort of sits at the crossroads of art and culture and sociology. And it's also, you know, it's very much has a place in the world. There is a connection to the world at large, as opposed to perhaps painting that's just coming from very much like an artist's interiority or an interior space. So and for me, like, I think as an artist, that back and forth between the ideas that I have within myself, or the questions that I have within myself, and how those questions relate to the world that exists outside of the shell that is my body, is really interesting for me as an artist. And I think photography kind of is like a link between those two spaces, this kind of interior and exterior space.
Yeah, and you know, you mentioned, you know, having a connection to the broader sort of social context. I think photography is probably the medium, sort of artistic medium, that we as just regular people sort of come into contact with the most, although not necessarily in an artistic context all the time. But it's interesting that we have a lot of sort of understandings and opinions about photography and how images sort of work, because we are so surrounded by them all the time. And that's sort of like a good segue into your Untitled Film Stills project, I feel like. So could you describe that project?
Sure. So I think it's important to get a context for that work. So I am an immigrant, actually refugee, fourth generation refugee. And when we came to this country, I didn't speak English or really have an idea of what the West was like. I mean, the only idea I had about Western culture was what I had seen as a child in museums. So my mom was really big into taking us to museums when I was a kid, the Hermitage and other museums when we lived in Poland. And so a lot of like the visual ideas about life and sort of the experience in the West came from art. Right before we left Poland, which was right before they basically closed the borders in 1980, they declared martial law. They had released like a Coca-Cola commercial. And that was really the first real glimpse, like current glimpse, that I had into like what life in the West might be like. We were really isolated, and I think it's really hard for Americans, especially today with social media and all these things, to kind of imagine how you can be in this kind of social bubble and not have a sense of what's happening just outside the border or in another country. And so when we came here, I didn't speak English. I didn't have really any sense of the culture. And so my parents really wanted us to assimilate into American life. And so we didn't live in what would be like an immigrant ghetto. Like, they could have very easily moved to a place where there was a lot of Polish people who spoke the same language and had the same customs. Instead, my parents thought it would be best for us to live in Lefrak City, which is a project complex in Queens, and I was the only white kid in my class not speaking English. And so the only way that I could really kind of get access to the culture and learn the language was through television. So media was a huge kind of part in an educational tool for me, and I think it is for most immigrants really who come here. I think they learn a lot of the language and also just the customs through television and movies. And I think media is also America's biggest export. I mean, we talk about gross national product, but really entertainment, television, movies are played internationally and they're dubbed. And so it is, I see all of that as sort of a educational device. And so I went out to the Midwest for graduate school. And when I was out there, that's as far west as I had been. And I really had I had lived on this East Coast bubble. I had no idea what the rest of the country looked like, except from what I had seen on television, and started to realize that there's this kind of vast world out there that I'm not aware of. And at that time, there was a kind of this resurgence as like these Manifest Destiny type films like Wyatt Earp and Young Guns. They're really popular in the 80s all the way through the 90s. And so I became interested in this idea of being like the explorer and how do I fit into that as a woman? And when a lot of these narratives about Manifest Destiny, both in terms of art and literature, and it's a space that's occupied by male characters. And it seemed very much a space that has been taken up and locked in and inaccessible to me. So I was interested in how do I fit in? How can I lay claim to a little piece of space for myself and also kind of form some kind of connection to this landscape that feels very distant and foreign to me? So I started watching these movies and looking for the single frames of unpopulated, empty landscape in the films. And that, at that time, we were still using either VHS tapes or DVD players. So it involved a lot of fast forward and stop and fast forward and stop to get the frame. And then I was shooting them onto Polaroid film and with a 4x5 camera. And this is like at the start of the digital age, really. So the Polaroids were then scanned in and retouched and printed onto a polyester paper, which is really shiny. And it was a paper that was used for bus shelters and primarily for marketing type images. And then those would be mounted to a curved aluminum backing so that they resembled drive-in movie screens. And what I found when I was going through all the films is that basically the landscape not only had been completely emptied of any meaning in the context of the films. So these landscapes that I was photographing were like curtains in the movie. They served as a break between action. Even though really in the historical context of the United States, the landscape is very loaded because it's the site of genocide, obviously. And most of these films, there's a kind of omission or erasure of the genocide that had occurred in the process of these kind of, you know, heroic characters that they portray, the genocide that is a large portion of them exploring the West is kind of negated. And so the movies seem emptied of their meaning. And yet there's this very strong reference to 19th century painting. And there's themes that kind of reoccurred, which was like these sunrises, sunsets, or valleys and plateaus or mountains. And they all fell into these three categories. And the images started to look very similar, even though the movies were quite different. And so I started to kind of organize them into groups. And I think this idea of editing and organizing is, again, something that's really central to photography. And I think it's something that I'm interested in. I mean, you know, even when you take a picture with a camera, essentially you're editing the space. So there's the whole idea of kind of creating a collection and then editing it down and then, you know, creating another collection. I think that that kind of editing process is very central to the making of work as a photographer. So a lot of my work kind of involves this idea of like distilling and then building up a collection and distilling again. And so that fit in. So they were essentially then organized into these groups of images, anywhere from 3 to 7 per group, and displayed together in a gallery. And the surface is really reflective. So the intent was that when the viewer enters into the space, these landscapes, which are empty, in fact, become populated with the movement of the viewer's reflection. No matter where you are in the gallery, you see yourself in the surface of the print. So there's this kind of reanimation that happens of the still image, and that was really important to me. So, and I think the other thing that was interesting for me in that work at that time was I was very much fighting the flatness of the photograph, and that's something that I still have a really hard time with, the fact of like the photograph being a window versus an object that exists in the space with the viewer. And so that three-dimensionality of the print was really important in that work. It was like, how can I kind of have the actual object of the print enter into the space of the viewer and actually be there present within the gallery, as opposed to something that you look into and get lost in, as you know, as a window onto another world that exists in a frame, and then you kind of forget the space of a gallery. So those are sort of the ideas that were central to that work. And I had been given an exhibition of that work at White Columns in 2001. Paul Ha had brought me in shortly before he left to go to St. Louis. And this was my big ta-da in New York. You know, I think any artist who has a exhibition, solo exhibition in New York would be excited. And White Columns is a great space with a long history. And the show opened shortly before September 11th, actually the Friday before September 11th. So I think September 11th happened on Wednesday, and the gallery is closed Sunday, Monday. So I think it had been open Friday night, Saturday, and then Tuesday, and then closed. So literally 3 days. and it didn't reopen because the gallery is on 13th Street. So it's sort of like it happened and it didn't happen. The work sold. It wasn't seen again. I always felt that it was somewhat cursed. I felt very strongly about that work, and as an artist, I felt like it had realized many of the things that were driving me, but at the same time, it kind of held a very kind of wounded place in my heart, because I felt like it never really got to realize its full potential because of the event. So from there, I kind of moved on, because I felt like that work, I was spending a lot of time in a dark room, fast forwarding and rewinding videos, and which I think a lot of people can kind of relate to as artists, but it's like, even some painters will tell you they start to feel like really isolated in their studio. And I was starting to feel like, well, maybe this thing with the September 11th, locking yourself in a dark room, kind of looking at the world through the lens of film, maybe that's not really what I should be doing. If I'm trying to understand this whole notion of, you know, masculine space and landscape and how I fit into that. So from there, I decided I was going to venture out into the world. And I did a body of work that essentially I followed in the footsteps of Monet and made a series of photographs of seascapes that were on composites. So I went.
Yeah, I saw those. I'm sorry to interrupt. You didn't present that work at Medium.
No.
And I found it just sort of when I was researching you afterwards. And it seemed like really different from the other work that you were presenting.
Yeah, it's highly aestheticized, very much like, you know, and I think the thing is too with Impressionism, it's like if you ask people who rarely go to museums to describe paintings that they know, they like usually will say they know Impressionists, you know, like they'll know a Van Gogh, or mm-hmm. they'll know Monet. Like that, it's like, I think Impressionism on many levels has become kind of kitsch in the sense that it's so accessible, even though I don't think, you know, there's a lot of depth to that work and there's a lot of ideas in that work. Mm-hmm. I think it's become like culturally equivalent of kitsch, a little bit like Andy Warhol, you know, where people just kind of, it is eye candy and people respond to it on a very superficial level and like it and recognize it, which as for somebody who works in a museum is always like good. At least people recognize artwork, but it's also kind of, again, it's a little bit like the landscapes I was working with. It empties the artwork of all the meaning because it just becomes all about this kind of superficial recognition. And yet, like, it's so iconic and it's shaped so much of art history. So I thought, okay, well, what if I actually literally go and stand in the places where he had painted these paintings, only to find out that he actually was painting from photographs. When you go to these places, you realize that the viewpoints that he's using are impossible. Hmm. And at the time that he was making these paintings, he had actually been told by his dealer to do so, because this was sort of the rise of the tourist industry. Mm. And people for the first time were able to go out to these seascapes in Brittany and the Channel Islands. And they actually had little guidebooks that would tell you where to go and literally where to stand to get the best view. So it was a highly orchestrated experience. And the people in the towns would actually dress up in costumes that they had worn maybe 80 years prior, but no longer dressed that way, and like reenact like as if they're fishing or doing kind of traditional work, specifically creating performances for tourists. So that idea of like the performative aspect of the landscape and all of that and how that's staged and constructed was really interesting to me. So I did a series of those landscape seascapes, and they were pretty large in scale. They're 54 by 44 inches. So they're fairly monumental. And then again, I felt like, well, here I am kind of walking around a landscape by myself. I felt like I needed to kind of confront the misanthrope in myself. And so at around that time, my brother, who I'm very close with, had a kind of a crisis, and I was taking care of him. He was here, and he was very fragile emotionally. And I felt that there was this kind of very strong connection between him and I, like as if we were interchangeable people. And had the circumstances been slightly different, I could very easily be in his position. And I also became very aware of the kind of locked in space that men go into when they're emotionally vulnerable, that there's no outlet for them to kind of channel that and what that means in the life of an individual, when really you're expected, there's certain behavior of strength that's expected in all circumstances, and you're in a position where you can't, you know, act the way that you're expected to. Mm-hmm. So I photographed a friend of mine who's a bachelor. I decided to do this series on bachelors because my brother's a bachelor. And I, at that time, my husband and I also had been trying to have kids. And so which looked like it wasn't going to happen, and it actually didn't. And so this idea of kind of the solitude, of life of solitude, was something that I was very much dealing with. And I sort of was interested in what that meant for men and how that paralleled to my own life. So I photographed this friend of mine who was a bachelor who made puppets. And when I took the portrait, just kind of did it as a, you know, just to try it out. When I took the portrait and I looked at the Polaroid, and again, I'm shooting 4x5 at this point, so pretty long, laborious process. And I looked at the portrait and I realized that the puppets were all self-portraits. And he had this performance that he did called Mr. Dead Guy. And it was just suddenly, like, all of these things that I was interested in were in that picture. So this idea of the performance, the space, like how the individual represents himself, how the home is arranged as a kind of museum to the self, or as a kind of a mirror reflection of the self. You know, what we do in our private space versus public space. So there was a lot of things that interested me in that work. And basically, I decided from there to start doing this series of bachelor portraits, which at that time I was doing with Craigslist initially, and it was a much more innocent time. This is around 2002 when I started this body of work. So Craigslist was still very kind of honest. You could put an ad up and not get a bunch of weirdos. And I basically put up an ad saying, you know, what I'm doing, and people who didn't know me would respond, and I would speak to them on the phone, explain the project, and then very graciously, a lot of them would let me come to their house and spend anywhere from 4 to 8 hours putting together a photograph, which we would collaborate on. So they would, you know, show me the spaces that they would like to be photographed in, and we would kind of stage the image together. And I would use the Polaroids as a way for them to see what's happening. And we would talk. And that talking component became a critical part of the project, because while I'm not a writer, photography in many ways is linked to writing, and that's sort of, you know, going back to its start. And I think that editing and building up, that's very much like a writing process, the idea of adding words and then editing down and to get the meaning. So I started to compile these kind of small haiku-like texts based on the conversations that I would have with the men during the time that I spent with them in their home. And they're really important to the work because they function as a secondary image. So the thing that really interested me was the preconceived notions that a viewer brings to an image when they look at a subject, especially of a person, and all of the things that you can't see in the picture. And how do you make the viewer aware of the space that's actually been edited through the photographic process? And so that language was critical to doing that. It kind of gives you a view onto the space that's either not readily available because of the way that the photograph is constructed, or literally it's not available because it deals with the interiority of the subject's mind. So that was critical, and they're shown together. And, you know, I did this project was an ongoing long-term project. It took about 10 years total. I actually took a job in the Midwest at one point so that I can work with a different demographic there I got a grant and was able to go down south and then also out west. So I was really interested in the idea of vernacular and how like the vernacular lifestyle kind of informs how people decorate their home and what men put in their home and the collections that they create. And I really wanted to get a sense of kind of a cross section throughout the United States. And so what I had was men who were over 35 who lived in homes, who lived in camper buses, who one gentleman, Leonard Knight, he lives in a place called Salvation Mountain out in the middle of the desert in California, which is now, I think, on the register of historic monuments or something like that because he's a self-taught artist. So there was a really wide variety of living situations, but they were all highly constructed and very intentionally put together by the men. And the men revealed very intimate things about themselves. And I think as a woman, I was privy to that. I don't think that a man would be able to do quite the same body of work because I think men naturally have to kind of play this role with each other and put up this shield of toughness, which I think with a woman, they feel they can let their guard down a little bit more. And so I feel like that the interior emotional vulnerability that many of the men have, and especially the men who dealt with abuse as children or in their life and who reveal that to me, I don't think they would necessarily reveal that to another guy. And I think that's something that as a society, we often don't consider the abuse suffered by boys and men and how that manifests itself later on in life. And, you know, and it's also the project took us through the time period of the recession in 2008. And there's like the symptoms of the recession, oncoming recession are revealed. So there's this fear of losing jobs. You know, a lot of the things that we see manifest today in the era of Trump and this kind of populist uprising and Tea Party and like obsession with militias and guns and, you know, a lot of that stuff, you kind of see it starting to percolate to the surface. And it was, and I think that looking back on the work, it's kind of interesting because it's like, it's giving us all these clues. And yet at the time you have no idea how it's going to pan out. And now here we are kind of looking back and saying, oh my, you know, like here are these guys telling me these, they're like sort of holding up a card, showing me the future. But you know, there was no way at that time I just wasn't maybe ready, or maybe we weren't ready as a society to kind of see the clues. Yeah. So that's sort of where I was at with that work.
It's, I mean, those portraits are, you know, I spent sort of a lot of time thinking about those bachelor portraits, since Medium and in sort of preparing to talk to you. And what's really striking about these images is how sort of vulnerable and almost kind of pathetic a lot of these men sort of come across in their sort of isolation. What's interesting to me, especially sort of in our current sort of social and political moment, is how much these men that you are photographing seem to be really craving a sense of intimacy, and that the photographic process that they're having with you and collaborating to make these images sort of provides an opportunity for them to have some form of human intimacy. Mm-hmm. And it seems like, God, like if that's something that men could kind of figure out for themselves a little better, maybe things wouldn't be quite so awful. You know?
Yeah, I think there's that component of it, the desire for like the human connection. And that's something that's very universal. And I think that's something that's very striking. Because again, I think, when you know, it's interesting the language you said, oh, these men seem so pathetic. And I think that's oftentimes the reaction. And yet, like, we forget, like in this world driven by social media where everything is based on likes and how much of yourself you expose to the outside world, that there's this long tradition of like the hermit or the, you know, ascetic who went and basically studies on their own. I mean, if we think about, you know, Buddha, right? this whole notion of like solitary enlightenment, and you know, that there's that tradition in Catholicism and in Muslim. I mean, I think basically any kind of faith that seeks to transcend the human experience, the idea of the ascetic existence is there. And yet, like today, we would look at that as something that's pathetic, or it's so counter cultural to what we have become as a society that's like all about spectacle and all about display and all about putting every last bit of yourself out there. So to some extent, I feel like maybe these guys are doing something that has been done since the beginning of time. Like they're in their own space trying to figure out like who they are and why they're here. And, you know, like the kind of big questions about human existence that I think, like, if we actually stop and you know, not be so wrapped up in work and all these other things that take up our time, like that we're kind of confronted with these like very scary questions of like, you know, are we just the speck of dust that's going to be gone tomorrow? Does our life matter? You know, why are we here? And those are questions that I think most people run away from most of their life. And for whatever reason, a lot of the guys that I photographed have had to confront that in their life. And that is, I think, a scary and devastating thing to be confronted with. And so that thing of being pathetic, yeah, that like that might come off that way. But at the same time, I feel like there's tremendous strength. Like many of these guys have had to deal with a weight of life that most of us will not ever be unfortunate enough to have to confront. And they every day somehow have to find a source of strength to keep going and to find meaning, you know, and to kind of find value in their life, despite the fact that people around them are telling them, well, what you're doing is pathetic.
I'm not sure if I necessarily meant it quite that way, but one of the things that strikes me about what you're saying is that when I think of somebody who's like an ascetic or like a monk or a hermit or something, I'm thinking about someone who's sort of made a choice for their life, you know, whereas yeah. I feel like a lot of the narratives, at least in the images in the series, because I haven't seen the whole series, but of the ones that I have seen, a lot of the narratives seem to be indicating that this isn't necessarily a choice that they made to be alone in their mm-hmm. lives, but rather it's something that they just sort of had to deal with. Yeah. And I think that is, I think maybe in when I say pathetic, I mean sort of more in the terms of like pathos rather than yes. being an object of pity necessarily, although I think there is sort of an aspect of that as well.
Yeah.
But I think like the title of the series, Bachelor Portraits, mm-hmm. I think that like that word bachelor has such a strong connotation in our society as mm-hmm. opposed to the feminine gendered version of that would be a spinster, which has a completely different connotation. Right. And in our culture, bachelors are often seen as sort of like this epitome of freedom and
the playboy.
Right.
Yeah.
But that's not at all what comes across in these images.
Yeah. And, you know, and I mean, I think that point you're bringing up is a good one. We do have these cultural ideas about what a bachelor is, but I think behind a lot of that flash and this kind of playboy and freedom, you know, my thinking is oftentimes those are ways to mask the very things that the men that I'm photographing for whatever reason are no longer able to mask. Mm. So I think this kind of like suffering or maybe questioning the pathos that you're referring to is there in both instances. It's just for whatever reason, the men that I photograph, the mask that they put on for the world has slipped. And that makes people very uncomfortable. You know, I think as a society, we're kind of uncomfortable with men who display vulnerability. And we don't really know what to do with that. That's just not the role that's ascribed to men. You know, men are supposed to be this kind of strong, free guys. And that's not always the case. And I think that's a really heavy burden for men to carry. And I think also women aren't really necessarily conscious of that, like what that means, because I think women oftentimes also project these kind of expectations onto men and how they're supposed to present themselves in the public sphere. Yeah, so I think that's a very interesting idea that you're talking about. And you know, and the Bachelor Portraits, the body of work actually started when that show The Bachelor came out. And so, you know, here I have my brother who's a bachelor, who's in crisis and extremely vulnerable and sensitive and like is like an open wound, right? And then I have this show where this guy, where there's basically, you know, he's got 20 women lining up and it's like this complete altered reality of what you know, I mean, it's presented as this, you know, ridiculous setup, that as if, you know, there's a guy out there and that just women are just going to line up and he's going to give them roses. And so, you know, and this was started at the time that reality TV was getting going as well. So there is a lot of this perception of like what these shows, how they alter how we perceive real life to be, you know, and like the life in the home. When I grew up, I have to say my parents were really anti-communist. And so the life inside our home was very radically different from how we depicted ourselves outside the home. So my parents listened to Radio Free Europe and they had friends who were very anti-communist and we're involved in a lot of anti-communist activities. We as kids knew that we would never allow to talk about that or say anything about that outside the home. So there was this kind of role playing of like what happens within the domestic space. And that's where you kind of express your real thoughts and feelings. And then when you leave, because you don't know whether one of your neighbors is an informant or not, you never really discuss those things. And so for me, that kind of dichotomy, I guess, is just part of how I grew up. But I see, you know, as we're kind of getting into the reality TV world, that's blurring. And I think that's always the case, you know, like family life and home life has always been one way. And then the public sphere of how people are in the workplace or when they're out in public has been different. I think now this whole kind of voyeuristic world that we live in, where there's constantly the view into that private space, or the disillusion, the dissolvement of private space, kind of warps that sense of like what is truly you versus the public you. And so I find that kind of fascinating.
Yeah.
And like, how does an individual protect themselves in a space where they're essentially like expected to be transparent, you know, like how do you keep like a sense of self when everything about you should be visible and available for assessment by other people?
I want to, this is actually really, there's like a million questions that I have going off of this, but I want to make sure that we have time to get to your Land of Epic Battles series.
Okay. Yeah.
So I think maybe we should sort of pivot a little bit.
Okay.
If that's okay.
Yeah. So at the same time that I was shooting the Bachelor portraits, I was also shooting women travelers.
Right.
And travelers are a community that rides the rails. And they basically network at that time through text messaging when I first got to know them. And they're basically kind of like this ascetic existence on the road. They're looking for adventure. They reject, you know, materialism. There's this whole like self-reliance component to it, very much like the idea of Western explorers or like somebody who would go into the land on their own for the first time. The thing that interested me about the women is that they're a small subset within this subculture, which was fairly difficult to gain access to. And generally they travel with their dog. And so there's this, you know, mythology of the boy and his dog. And I was interested, what does that look like when it's a woman and her dog? And so I was creating this kind of parallel series while the men, I was spending a lot of time with them. The women are very fleeting. It's like photographing a butterfly that you see for 3 seconds and then they're on the train and off to the next destination. So sort of working on those two bodies of work. And then in 2015, for whatever reason, I decided that I wanted to revisit the film stills. I felt like that body of work was kind of left hanging, unfinished. And I was interested in how the idea of film or media for men had changed now that we have the internet and there's, you know, direct access viewing and streaming. So when I started to look at movies, I really said, well, you know, Hollywood is not really the main source for these kind of cultural, educational images that are put out. It's more YouTube and direct access. And when you're talking about masculine or macho type imagery, ISIS is really that on steroids. So this idea of kind of these violent Western films from the 80s and 90s, we now have these violent films that take place in the desert or in Afghanistan. And so I started to look at those videos. The first video that I watched, and I really had no idea what I was getting into when I first did it, was there had been a Jordanian pilot that had been captured and ISIS had released a video where they put him in a cage and set him on fire. And it's extremely graphic. It's extremely violent. It's the most like vile and disturbing thing I have ever seen in my life. It gave me nightmares for weeks because you're literally seeing the flesh melt off of this person as they're burning alive. And I really didn't quite know what to do with that, but I did want to return because there are the sort of, as they pan around, there are these little snippets of empty space. And so as somebody who's like very sensitive and like an animal lover and just really believes in kindness, it was really hard for me to kind of grapple with that imagery and what to do with it. And so again, I started to look for these little slivers where I can access this, make it my own, knowing full well that I am not the intended audience for this material. As a woman, I specifically am supposed to be kind of locked out of these videos. And I also wanted to use gunpowder. And the gunpowder goes back to the September 11th bombing and this idea of imagery that's actually explosive, like literally explosive, even though the images themselves aren't necessarily of explosions. So I did some research, and the bomb making material of choice was black powder, which is literally a powder as opposed to pellets, which is what contemporary gunpowder is. And it had been restricted after September 11th. And I actually was able to get my hands on some. I went to a gun shop and just bought some with cash illegally, even though you're supposed to technically have a musket shooting permit. And I spent a year doing testing with different processes to get the gunpowder to work so that I can make photographic images using this as a pigment. So after about a year of testing, after I had pretty much run out of all other options, I tried casein, and that process worked. And I was told not to use that this stuff was crap, that it's really unpredictable. But for whatever reason, it did work. I finally got an image as opposed to everything just kind of sliding off the paper. And so this body of work started to kind of evolve out of that. And I basically break it up into sessions where I watch videos very intensely for about a month straight. So the videos are produced oftentimes by AMUC, which is the ISIS media agency. They have their own media agency that produces newscasts, but also films. The production level is pretty high, especially in 2015 when I started doing this. They were using very sophisticated high-end video cameras, shooting from multiple angles. There's clearly a storyboard for these. They're shot with, you know, oftentimes two cameras simultaneously, so you get multiple views. There's pretty sophisticated soundtracks that go along with them. They're kind of formulaic in how they're structured. So there's usually a high-end graphic that opens up the film. There's kind of a historical background or some kind of background for what's going on. Then there's usually a guy that talks at you for a period of time. And then usually prisoners or somebody who's committed some kind of crime that they consider against the caliphate. And then there's the mutilation or sort of bodily destruction. They also have videos where they are actually rolling into battle, and they kind of celebrate the camaraderie of brotherhood in battle. And that work, or those films, they very much have a lineage to Western tradition. You know, this whole tradition of painting war, or glorifying war in paintings, and very violent scenes in paintings. That goes back to probably the Renaissance, and it kind of reached its height in the 17th, 18th, and 19th century with colonialism. And a lot of the videos are actually employing images from Western media. So they're using the kind of language that was sent out and used as an educational cultural device is now being appropriated, assimilated, and then recontextualized for a different purpose. And I find that really interesting because, again, that functions like language. It's kind of evolution of language. So, so basically I get really large digital negatives. I use the camera as a computer. The computer is a camera, excuse me. So rather than going out physically taking the pictures, I'm basically, the pictures are on the screen and I'm doing screenshots. So the computer has basically become my 4x5. Again, it's a careful editing process, and I capture, you know, hundreds of these screenshots, and then they have to go through a process of being rezzed up and then printed as a digital neg and then contact printed using the gunpowder. And it's usually 4 to 8 layers per print. They're handmade, And each of the prints is different. Even though I could follow the same process, the same combination of chemicals printed on the same day, the prints do turn out to be unique because the gunpowder does react with the emulsion in its own kind of specific way. So I was interested in the materiality of the print and working prints by hand and how that relates to 19th century photographs of, Henri Lesecq or Gustave Le Gray. Those are photographers who photographed Nubia, Egypt, Palestine in the 1840s and 50s and using paper negatives and also dichromate process. So I'm kind of going back to the very roots of photography and the contested landscape of those images. And yet again, the same contested landscape reappearing, but now in this video format. And the images are titled using the titles of the videos in which they appeared. So things like neck cutting or the making of illusion or crush your enemies. So the violence is not in the actual images itself. It's suggested in the titles.
It's interesting, these gunpowder prints that you make, when you come to them as images, a lot of that context is sort of not necessarily readily apparent when you just come to the image itself. The titles definitely do a lot of work to add that context back in. You know, when I look at these photos, you know, any one of them, some of them maybe more than others, but, you know, any one of them doesn't necessarily convey necessarily a lot of, I'm not sure exactly how to articulate what I'm saying, but like it's really in like having more than one of them, having sort of a series of them, that you get this sort of sense of menace and this sort of dark energy to them, if that sort of makes sense.
Yeah, completely.
What's interesting to me is, like, I wonder how I would interpret these images if I hadn't come to them in the way that I did, where in your presentation, you actually showed us some of these really graphic videos and then showed us these images, which I kind of wonder if that maybe puts them in a different context than if I'd come to the images cold. But I do think that there's, you know, when you look at the images on their own, there's enough in them. And then especially when you combine them with the titles, that it sort of leads you in that direction, although maybe not in quite as graphic, you know, or shocking a way. I don't know.
I think you nailed a couple things on the head. So one is that I, as an image maker, I tend not to work with a singular image. And I think there's a number of people who are like really about the single image. And for me, I tend to work sequentially and to work in groups. You could see that from the film stills all the way through to the bachelor portraits, the fact that there's multiple images in one. And I don't know whether that's something that's like ties back to my interest in film or the just generally narrative, or whether, again, it ties back to photography's connection to language and the fact that you would have multiple words to create meaning in a sentence. But I tend not to think in a kind of a singular image way. I tend to think of things in groups. So yeah, I think that buildup of one image on top of the other is really important, just for me as in terms of how I work as a process, but also in terms of conveying the darkness that you're talking about. I think for me, the thing that was interesting was, A, the ISIS videos that I showed, those are videos that I think most people do not watch. Clearly, there's an audience for those on the dark web that's very specific. And that connection, like directly to a willing and open audience member, is something that I find very fascinating about media today. So I think most people, whether it's through personal, like just unknowingness or a desire to remain oblivious of what's really going on, haven't seen these images and don't really know what's going on in the videos. And that's probably for the best, because I do think that they're very violent and there is like an element of psychological damage that I think that is inherent in watching these things. But the thing that interests me is this idea of clues and how I think with terrorism, a lot of it isn't about like this kind of overt imagery. With those videos, the thing that's terrifying isn't the fact of like somebody getting burned alive or their heads getting cut off, which are meant to kind of intimidate their enemies. It's the video that they show where basically just after the bombing in Paris, they have a guy in Belgium walking past heavily armed guards filming, and he basically is able to get through all the security. And the title of the video is called "We Are Still Here." And so I think in many ways, like, terrorism is about instilling a sense of paranoia. Hmm. And my work is about how do you kind of convey that sense of paranoia. And it's through these subtle clues that, like, you could almost put your finger on what's going on, but you're not 100% sure. You get a sense that something, you know, there's something not quite right, but it's not so obvious that you feel, you know, it's a red flag. And so, yeah, the images kind of need to build up one upon the other to get a sense of, like, what is that really that's happening that's not quite right in these work, in this work? And then also the fact that, like, you know, the gunpowder's there, and just by looking at it, you wouldn't necessarily know that. The material as a conceptual component of the work is really important. But it's, again, one of those things that you could be looking at that's extremely kind of dangerous or threatening, and yet on surface, it looks like a black and white print. So a lot of it is about this kind of hidden or not necessarily readily seen danger that's present. And it's like the dark web, like, it's there, but we don't see it, right? Yeah. Like, unless you have a direct subscription and you're kind of infiltrating these sites where the audience is a targeted audience, you're not necessarily going to know what is going on. But it is there, and it is like a completely parallel world that's happening, just, you know, not out in the open. And so for me, like, that's really fascinating. And I think also, like, as a woman, where I'm like, this is not a world that's for me. Like, how do I infiltrate that? Like, how do I take it? How do I take this language that's been appropriated, used, and then I appropriate and use it for myself and lay claim to it?
Yeah. I could keep talking about this, but I think we should take a quick break and then come back and do the second segment.
Okay. So, Mike, I feel like I'm talking a lot, and I know you have a background in writing, I think, right?
Yeah.
And, like, I would, and I'm talking a lot about the relationship between photography and language, and I'm kind of really fascinated to hear your thoughts on those things. Yeah, because for me, like, I just find writing as a medium and the process that's involved in that is just so radically different from creating visual work. And I'm always really interested in hearing writers, especially, like, novelists and things, of how the process of writing a book. And, like, so when I'm talking about language, you know, I know that I'm coming at it from a very different place than somebody who writes. Hmm. And I'm always, like, really interested in hearing their thoughts on language and the relationship between visual imagery or photography and language, or writing and language, or writing and photography. Yeah. So, not to put you on the spot or anything.
is that what you would what you'd like to do for the second segment, or is that just sort of an in-between thing? Or
that's an in-between thing. Okay. Yeah, but yeah, we could do that too. I mean, you know, I am really interested in, because, like, photography intrinsically has this relationship with language as, like, a means to illustrate words, right? This whole thing of journalism and how the relationship between a story and the picture. And, like, for me, I'm always kind of trying to wrap my brain around that, like, whether or not an image can exist on its own, and what does it mean when it exists in relationship to written words on a page, you know, and how I see written language versus, like, somebody who actually uses writing as a primary, you know, medium and sees images. So, yeah.
I mean, first of all, I should say I'm not actually a novelist. So I'm
it's okay.
Yeah. I have immense respect for novelists, but it's something that has thus far eluded me. I'm primarily as a writer and essayist. And I think that images can be used to illustrate text, or the other way around. But mm-hmm. I find usually that it's a little less interesting when that's all that's happening. And what I thought was interesting about your bachelor portraits is in the way that the image and the text are each doing something that the other one isn't doing. Mm-hmm. you know, I think that there's things that each medium does really well, but that each one also has sort of its weaknesses, things that it mm-hmm. doesn't do well. And so when you're able to combine them in ways where each one's strength is complementing the other, that's really interesting. And I think that what you've done by combining the text and images with the Bachelor portraits is an example of that, you know, because the text, what text is really great at is interiority, you know, is in describing things in a sensory way and in an emotional way, where an image can elicit those same sort of sense and emotional memories, but they do it in a more indirect way. But the other thing that an image can do that text just never can is provide, especially with photography, is mm-hmm. provide a sense of concreteness and attachment to the physical world. Mm-hmm. That's sort of one of the things I think about a lot, because a lot of my own work does sort of combine text and images, even though I also do some that are just one or the other, but I'm really interested in that, in how they can come together.
And for me, it's like, so, you know, I think I'm kind of damaged goods, having been raised under communism with this family that was anti-communist. And so there's this skepticism about images. When I used to go to visit my grandmother in Russia, they had this newspaper called Pravda, which means truth. And my brother and I used to write 10% in front of the Pravda, meaning that 10% was truth. And my grandmother used to have to burn the newspapers, because if any of the neighbors would see that, that would be enough for you to actually get hauled off to prison. Yeah. But we had kind of an understanding, because like the textbooks, you know, as soon as somebody would die, they would like alter the photos in the textbooks. So like this person who was part of the government suddenly disappears from all the photos. And so there's kind of this skepticism about photographic truth, and maybe it's maybe flipped for me. And like this, so for when I was writing these things for the Bachelor portraits, I was terrified, because for me to put the words down on the page, those are so concrete. And my mother always says, my thoughts are the only thing that are my own. And so this idea of like actually putting your thoughts down in black and white on a page has a sense of gravity that for me was just so enormous, that perhaps a photograph doesn't have, because a photograph, the interpretation could be changed much more easily, you know, or it's much more ephemeral, the interpretation of a photograph, whereas words seem so kind of weighty and concrete to me.
Well, I think that's the thing, right, is that with words, there's less, especially if you're writing in a descriptive way rather than, you know, writing fiction or poetry or something, where there's the interpretation isn't really necessary, because you can just communicate that directly. Mm-hmm. But also because when you're writing, everybody understands that writing comes from the writer's point of view. Mm-hmm. So there is already an understanding that what you're being presented with is sort of, I don't want to use the word opinion exactly, because mm-hmm. I think it's stronger than just something that's, oh, that's just my opinion, but it's coming, you know, loaded with whatever personal biases the person who's telling you these things has. Whereas the image in our culture is often sort of, because the photograph as a document is something that we have so long understood to be, photographs are truthful, even if you're not necessarily trying to present the photograph as truthful, that the fact of a photograph is sort of implies that it's being presented as truthful. So that can feel sort of more sneaky in a way, you know, mm-hmm. Like that you can have an awareness that the photograph is lying, but because the photograph isn't telling you that it's lying, that it feels maybe less true than something that is obviously coming from a perspective like writing does. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah. And I'm just sort of thinking about, you know, in today's, like this media culture that I've been talking about, and how maybe that truthfulness of images, how that's been undermined. And so there's this use of like these direct web streaming or like citizen journalists, right? Mm-hmm. As a way of to try to kind of bring back that foundation of truthfulness, which I don't think was ever there really to begin with. But to kind of somehow hold on to that, and that somehow if it's more direct and people are able to post their own things, that somehow they are more true. That's really, I mean, interesting. You know, the idea of the singular voice is somehow holding more weight in terms of truth than a kind of a populist voice or a voice of expertise, for example.
I mean, I think it comes down to, you know, when you're speaking with your voice, or if you're doing it through the proxy of written language, you are presenting yourself as a person, right? And with all of the sort of, you know, fallibilities and everything that is implied by that. But it also means that you can have someone to trust, right? Like you have a relationship with the person who's listening to you, even if that person isn't someone who's in the room with you or that you know personally, there's still some kind of a relationship. Whereas the image can feel more removed and disconnected than that, but it purports to present itself as some form of objective reality, which we all, of course, know at this point it isn't, but it still sort of feels that way because of how we're indoctrinated to understand photographs. But you don't have, in the same way, you don't feel the connection in the same way with the photographer, or at least I don't think the layperson often does feel the same connection with the photographer, especially not in a more journalistic style of imagery. You know, and I think, you know, these days, especially when there's so much, you know, I hate the term, but fake news or whatever, eventually it sort of comes down to, well, who do you trust, and what are the relationships that form that trust? And in that way, writing can be very powerful.
Yeah, I think this idea of kind of clannish or clanism that's coming back, even if it's on a global scale, is sort of very interesting. You know, so like as the world has become more populated and like boundaries more kind of easily moved, suddenly people are kind of forming new kinds of clans or kind of reverting back to this kind of tribal behavior, which is really kind of a fascinating idea to think about and what drives that. You know, I think like as an immigrant, like always like thinking about trying to fit into the space that you're in, knowing that you're kind of always like from the outside looking in, the formation of these clans and like what are kind of the parameters of being part of a certain tribe or outside of a certain tribe is really fascinating.
It is. It's also kind of terrifying to watch that happening sort of in real time in front of you It doesn't do anything great for my anxiety.
Sorry. It's just really interesting to think this is like some sort of part of our like reptilian brain that just naturally like we kind of drift towards that behavior. No matter how evolved we become, like, you know, every century or every other century, we kind of drift back towards this kind of tribal behavior. And what are the things that drive it, and what are the parameters of like how somebody decides what tribe they're part of or not? It's, you know, I'm like a big fan of like historical novels, and part of that is like I always love when somebody does really great research and presents the character in the book as like you get inside their head and you get their thoughts. Like I read this book called the Autobiography of Joseph Stalin, and my mother lived through Joseph Stalin, and it's like in this book, suddenly you're like understanding like, well, wow, this makes sense. This is why he would do these things. And this is the way that he thought, you know, and it's just this kind of insight into human behavior is something that I just find really fascinating. Human beings are just infinitely perplexing and fascinating at the same time. It's like a puzzle that you'll never figure out.
Yeah. There's something about writing because it enables you to access interior spaces, you know, like people's thoughts and emotions and feelings and memories and things like that in such a direct way. I find myself a little bit more moved to empathy by writing than I am by images alone, usually, not always, but because I think some images can do that also. And you know, obviously, with in either case, it sort of depends on what the artist or writer is trying to accomplish with their work. But, you know, when you're talking about Stalin. This, like, obviously, huge historical figure, dictator, tyrant, like,
Not
did
somebody you want to feel sorry for.
no, like, he's responsible for any number of atrocities, even just the ones that we know about. I think there's something really interesting about the idea of having empathy for someone who's awful. But, one of the things, and this is something that my therapist and I have talked about a fair amount, but just to be able to have empathy for someone without condoning the things that they have done, like, there's something about that that I think is a really powerful idea, you know?
Yeah, I think that's true. And I think in some ways the Gunpowder Prince, the most recent work, is kind of about that. It's like I by no means am condoning ISIS. I think that the things that they're doing and the people who have participated, there's something seriously warped, demented, and there's crimes against humanity. They're obviously involved in this. And yet when I watch the videos, I see, a 12-year-old boy being told that, he's not going to feel anything when the car blows up and he'll be fine, and driving this kind of Franken truck bomb and blowing up other people. And I can't help but feel empathy for somebody whose brain isn't formed enough to understand the consequences of what they're doing, and that they've been pulled into this. I think, like, as a human, it's really hard to not feel empathy for somebody who's young and who doesn't maybe have the experience life-wise, or maybe doesn't have the opportunities in life that would kind of give them a window onto an option outside of that. So yeah, I think it's really interesting, like, this idea of empathy. And I think, even like with today's America and the people who voted for Trump, and when I was out in the Midwest photographing the bachelors, I came across a lot of people who think like that. And it's like, if you talk to them face to face, they could be just as much of a normal, nice person as the next guy. But yet in a group, suddenly there's this kind of thing that takes over, and that, thought pattern or behavior or inclination suddenly is transformed into something that's really negative and destructive. And so I think that idea of, like, empathy and yet not condoning the actions, is really important. I think it's important to kind of to be able to keep your own sense of humanity, to be able to do that. Because when you stop feeling empathy for other people, it's like you're kind of, again, reverting to, like, the reptilian brain. And that's not a really good place to be for either yourself or the planet.
I mean, I think, one of the things, too, is that, I think that it's very important to have empathy for all people. One of the things that I think a lot about when, in terms of our current political situation is how little empathy there often is towards people who are more marginalized by people who are more privileged. And, obviously that goes in a lot of different directions. And most applicable to the work that you do is in how men have so little, I don't know if ability is quite the right word, but so little skill and so little education in how to empathize with other people and how to even empathize with themselves and have the vocabulary and the emotional understanding and intelligence to be able to have the language even to understand what needs they're trying to get met when they do certain things and why they do these things. It's really tragic. No less so because, that tragedy is then visited upon other people who have less power to protect themselves. And then I think that sort of plays out in a lot of different axes of privilege, whether it's being a man in our society, or being white in our society, or being straight in our society, or being affluent in our society, and not having the ability to actually look around at people whose situations are different from yours and understand their humanity and accept their humanity, and to be able to have any awareness of situations being different from our own is such a, I mean, it really just seems like that is what underlies all of these things, that everyone is dealing with their own fears and anxieties, but because they don't have some awareness of other people, that then they're willing to dehumanize and victimize these other people. And I don't know, that to me is sort of sums it up. And why, and really why art and writing and language matter so much, because these are the ways that we can form those connections and form empathy and interrogate these things and try and form those vocabularies. You know, that to me is the real deal, you know?
Yeah, I think the idea of like art and bearing witness is really important, even if art can't maybe on its own transform or change the circumstances of the world. The very fact of it bearing witness and serving as a record is, I think, fundamentally important to humanity being able to process events that may be too traumatic at this time, but will still need to be dealt with in the future. And I think this idea of empathy, you know, the thing with the men portraits that I find so interesting is that the things of ISIS, people say that the pictures are scary, but when I show them the pictures of the bachelors, they say, oh my God, you're so brave. What did your husband think? How could you do this by yourself? And to me, it's like so interesting. It's like, these are human beings. Like, if I am going to be afraid of another human being, that's really, I don't know if that's like a really healthy place for me to be as a person, to have just an inherent fear of my fellow man, and for without really a basis. And so a lot of it was this confrontation of like personal fear or fear that I'm supposed to have. I didn't use an assistant when I did that work, and specifically because I wanted it to be a one-on-one interaction. I didn't want it. I already was coming in with a camera, so I felt like, even though I'm a woman, I'm coming in from this place of power because I have this machine that I can kind of hide behind, even though it's a 4x5 and I'm not really hiding behind it. I use a cable release specifically so I could keep talking to the men. Mm-hmm. But still, I wanted it to be on this kind of equal footing. So these guys are letting me into their home, which is a private space where they're very vulnerable, you know, and I didn't want it to be this kind of subject artist type relationship. I really wanted it to be on a much more equal footing. So it was, and I think that's what kind of lent the text portion of it a lot of the strength, because they felt that I wasn't in a place that's judgmental or kind of up above them. Mm-hmm. They felt, we felt like we're coming from a very much an equal place of vulnerability. Like, I was vulnerable. I'm in their home. I don't know them. I don't know their background. And then they also don't necessarily know me, and they're trusting me to create a work that, you know, many of them didn't really want to see the pictures when they're done. They didn't want copies of the photos, and which I thought was really interesting. They kind of trusted me to make work that would be okay. And I think that idea of empathy is really important, and making oneself vulnerable and not being afraid of like what would technically be the other, you know, kind of seeing yourself in the other. I think is really important today, especially.
Yeah, it is. It's hard to sort of reconcile sometimes. I think there's an emotional truth to the idea that living in fear is unhealthy, but then it can be difficult to square that sometimes with the idea that there's actual real danger in the world sometimes as well. And that's, I think, something that we all are kind of reckoning with right now, you know, that, I don't know. I know that a lot of people are dealing with a lot of tension and anxiety and stress. I mean, I think obviously that's something that people have dealt with forever, but like right now it's very heightened for a lot of people. And how to sort of square that can be, you know, it's hard to get your arms around.
Yeah. I think, you know, I think as America, I think we're kind of driven, we're kind of a culture of fear. And a lot of it is not really based in reality. I wonder, you know, people who live in these like totalitarian regimes or, you know, places where things actually, bad things really do happen a lot, whether they have that same level of kind of anxiety that Americans have. I think as a culture, we are driven by fear, and I'm not quite sure where that fear comes from. You know, it's like a fear of losing things, yet we're like, we have a very comfortable quality of life compared to most people in the world. You know, there's a fear of violence, even though relatively speaking, this country's pretty safe compared to other countries. We have a, you know, compared to other countries with murder rates much higher than ours and violence rates much higher than ours. It's like there's all these kind of layers of fear. And I oftentimes think about what is sort of the driving catalyst for that in this country, whether it's like we have just gotten so comfortable that any little thing that might shake our world causes anxiety or whether there is really something deeply and profoundly true to having that fear. And I haven't really come to any clear conclusions about it, other than the fact that I oftentimes think people, it's like they're afraid of a danger that doesn't actually exist.
Yeah. I mean, I think that it's one of the things that's worth pointing out here is that I think a lot of our political and sort of societal discourse is driven by anxiety that might, I don't know if it would be entirely baseless, but, you know, think people being worried about things, you know, whether it's crime or violence or whatever, that doesn't actually appear in their lives very much. But I think that it's also worth noting that for many people, those things do appear in their lives. It's just those aren't the people that are making the decisions in the world, mm-hmm. right? Like, you know, for a lot of African-American communities, there is violence that is not, and, you know, people want to talk about black-on-black violence, but there's also, you know, state violence that is visited upon those communities. You know, similarly, there is a lot of domestic violence that is disproportionately victimizes women. And yet, you know, in our culture, it's most of the decision makers still at this point, and, you know, as we're recording this, are still men. And the men are the ones who are, you know, oftentimes expressing fears about these things. So I think that it's that to me, that's the really interesting dichotomy, is that the people who might be enacting policy based out of fear, or who might be, you know, structuring their communities based on these anxieties, are often not the ones who are the actual victims of mm-hmm. real danger. You know, not to say that real danger doesn't exist for other people, though. It is sort of a strange thing. And I always sort of wonder how much of it is just sort of based on a fundamental insecurity, based on realizing that things are fairly good, you know, and that things are not this good for everyone, you know?
Yeah. I mean, you know, I live in Philadelphia. We have some violent crime here. And one of my neighbors, who happens to be African American, had five boys. Her and her husband had six boys total. Three of the boys actually were victims of murder. And all after the age of 18. So I don't want to give the impression that there's, you know, everything's perfect. I think as an African American mother of boys, I think this country can be a pretty scary place. You know, I think when you lose three kids in a family to random violence and murder, I honestly don't know where she finds the strength to go on every day. Mm-hmm. I think that would be something that would just be completely soul crushing. And I work with people who also had grandsons, et cetera, who've been murdered, you know, and I think that as a fear of an African American mother, I can understand that fear. I can understand where you would be afraid to let your kid out the door. You're not quite sure where to go, where it would be safe for your child. And those kinds of fears, I think, are logical. But I think these kind of mob-like fears that oftentimes drive this country, and like it's attacks from, like, there's this also kind of like this fear of invasion from other countries that's like, to me, is like bizarre.
It is pretty bizarre.
Like as if like aliens are going, I mean, like, you know, I think alien movies actually are kind of a symptom of this fear of like invasion of outside, you know, like, it's not only is it going to be other countries, aliens will also invade us. That to me is weird, and I can't quite wrap my brain around that. But I think there is a lot of violence, especially gun violence in this country. And yet that's stuff that's not really addressed or talked about. The things that really should be scary are not talked about. And then there's all this kind of stuff that's illogical and that is kind of like, seems to be like a cultural driving force. Like you said, and I think it's like important as a country, like we kind of face those things as a nation, you know, like I think it's important to confront the history of genocide that exists in this country. I think there's this kind of inheritance of fear that's in the African American community that's created by slavery, where you really don't know what somebody is going to do because they have a right to do whatever they want. And I could see how that would cause a great deal of anxiety, and it just becomes kind of genetic after a while. You know, it's like how many generations of that fear, like generations living through that fear, and it sort of becomes like a genetic marker of sorts. And I think there needs to be a reckoning of that, the fact that there are certain people in this country who don't feel safe and they have a history of not feeling safe, and what that means, and, you know, how do we tackle that, and having empathy for people. You know, when this whole thing with Trump, I think a lot of women, especially who are not white, they felt not safe. Like, they were worried if they walked down the street that somebody might spit at them or a man would say something or grab them, you know, and I don't think they're necessarily wrong. I was in New Orleans and I had, for the first time ever, I had, you know, men behave inappropriately towards me. And it's, you know, it's sort of a interesting time we live in. And yet at the same time, I have this kind of undying thing that I will not give in to that, because I'm not going to let this kind of cultural, I don't know, it's like some kind of trance take over my life, and try and change fundamentally who I am as a human being and how I react to other human beings. I think it's important to kind of live in a place of truth within yourself.
Yeah. I think one of the things that kind of gives me a little bit of hope is that, you know, I think it's true that historically we haven't had these conversations about the things that are really the real problems rather than the perceived problems. But I think more and more nowadays we are heading towards that reckoning, or at least hopefully, you know, that more people are having these conversations. And even if it's not made its way up to, you know, as wide a consciousness as it would really need to in order to truly have a reckoning, I feel like it's closer than it's ever been at any point that I can remember in my life. So, you know, I feel like there's reason to be hopeful, you know, but of course then, you know, it's still also, you know, hope without work isn't really worth much. So, that's one of the reasons why I want to do things like have this show and have conversations and make art, write any of these things. I think that all is to the good.
Yeah. And I think, you know, one of the topics that I had brought up for discussion was this idea of like social practice and what is the role of the artist in society. And like, you know, I think there's such kind of large issues right now that we're confronting. And I think in many ways, there's these expectations for art to be the kind of the savior. I'm always coming from this place of like fallibility, you know, and vulnerability. And I wonder if, you know, I think art can be a savior. I know it was for me when I lived in the communist bloc, and what it meant for me in terms of providing a window onto a world. And like the mayor of Philadelphia has talked about when he was a 16-year-old child and went to the museum for the first time and how transformative that was for him. But I also wonder about having this really high social expectation pinned onto art and artists, that it must perform this kind of social function, and that it has to have some kind of measurable component to it, which oftentimes work is made and it might not register until, you know, a generation or two later in terms of the significance or what it was doing. I find that really, I don't have a problem with social practice per se, but I do find it that it's like there's this kind of push to put a load on artists to kind of be community organizers or community. And it's like, not every artist is going to be able to do that. And not every artwork is going to function that way. And I think putting that kind of expectation then somehow diminishes other work, which may be doing or creating change or knowledge or just bearing witness, but it may not do it in the way that's kind of culturally expected right now. And so it's sort of an interesting time to be an artist. And also like coming from, you know, communist country where there was socialist realism and there was this expectation on art moving the masses, and seeing that happening in a country that's supposedly democratic. And it's like right away, that gives me kind of like pause for concern. Like it's like the opposite side of the same coin. You know, that was a failed experiment. And are we like setting ourselves up once again for a failed experiment that art should be this kind of be all save all for the world?
You know, the way that I think about it is, you know, I have seen people talking about this and some people calling for art that's more explicitly political. The thing that I always push back on that is like, I don't know if there is such a thing as art that is not political in some way or not socially commentating in some way, because art is an expression of humanity, and it comes from a person and it is going to a person. It's communicating something. I don't know if you can do that without having politics involved in it in some way. And what I think about in terms of, you know, my own work, for example, is all very personally focused. And I'm talking about very specific experiences and emotions of my own life, usually, whether I'm writing a personal essay or, you know, making a photo book that is about the feeling of not being able to go home again, you know. And these are all important in my life. And I think that hopefully there are things that other people can relate to, but they're not directly commenting on, you know, immigration policy or something like that. What I always think to myself is that I don't think that art, or rather, I don't think that a work of art or an artist can change the world. But I do know that one work of art can change a person if that person is receptive to it and gets it at the right time and moment in their life. That can happen. And so maybe art can't change the world, but if it changes enough people, that is changing the world. What's interesting to me is, you know, when I look at your work, for example, that so much of your work is about interrogating our conception of masculinity. And you're not out there like taking pictures of people getting deported or, you know, the halls of government or whatever, but interrogating masculinity and finding new ways to talk about these things is, to me, one of the most important social issues of our time, you know? And I think that understanding masculinity and how it's toxic and how it has led us to so many of these sort of toxic situations, like, that is a profoundly political conversation to have, profoundly political and social conversation. And that if people can see work like that and be moved by it and come to a new understanding of masculinity in their own lives, if some man can see this work and recognize a need for change in himself along those lines and become more intimate and more vulnerable, like, how is that not changing the world, you know?
Yeah, I mean, what you're just saying about, you know, it just made me think of the Schindler, like, save one life, you save the world. And I think for me as an artist, I hope if I could just reach like one person, but it just has to be the right person, you know, like what if somebody had like reached out to Joseph Stalin and shown him something that would have been transformative, you know, and like what a different place the world would be if he had some kind of like experience, you know, that where he had this self-realization. And, you know, like a lot of my guys, I feel to some extent, they're like realized people because at least they have admitted that they've had this trauma and the effect that it's had on their life. And like, that's like the first step to self-realization is like seeing yourself for what you really are and what you've really gone through. And I feel like so many people are not there yet. For me, maybe, you know, if the right person sees this, like it could be this big thing. But as an artist, I have no control over who sees the work or how ultimately transformative or non-transformative it is for them. And so this kind of element of trying to quantify artwork and its impact on the viewer, to me, I find it kind of like a scary and rather dangerous slippery slope. I have no problem with people making work that's political. I actually think it's fantastic. But I think to kind of put that burden on art in general, I think is kind of starting to slip into totalitarianism. And basically, you know, creating value by something that's marketable and measurable. And art isn't always that. You know, sometimes art is just this fleeting, beautiful thing that happens, and there's no way to kind of put it in a jar and put a label on it and sell it on a shelf.
Yeah. I do think that, you know, I mean, obviously, the sort of intersection of commerce and art is something that people have been talking about forever, probably, you know, hundreds or maybe even thousands of years, who knows, like, and the idea of commodifying some kind of, you know, personal experience is strange to say the least, but it is sort of the world that we live in. But I think ultimately nobody makes art in order to just, you know, I mean, I guess some people might make a piece and then just put it in a drawer somewhere and say like, okay, I'm done now. But I don't think anybody puts art out into the world with the hope that people aren't going to connect with it, you know? Like, I think people are making art and putting it into the world because they want to have some form of connection. And I think any kind of connection that you have with anybody, even though you can't control it, you can just, all you can do is put your message out there, whatever that is, and hope that somebody understands it. But, you know, that moment of understanding is a moment of change, I think, you know? Mm-hmm. So, you know, I see art as a very, you know, not that it has a responsibility to do anything more than what it's trying to do, but that it is nevertheless a very powerful medium for change on a small scale, you know, on a personal scale. And I think that all change has to start with that, you know, because if it doesn't start with a person, it doesn't start anywhere.
Yeah. And then there's this other component to that too, that I feel like as a woman, and as a woman artist, you know, this idea of sort of social change and the idea of mothering or playing the den mother, I feel like that is a really kind of unfair space to place on me as a woman artist, that like, that ultimately like my work should have this nurturing quality to it. And while I'm not against being nurturing, I also don't feel like, you know, that that's something that should be like a requirement of mine. And I don't feel like that's necessarily something that men artists are saddled with all the time.
Absolutely.
So it's just, you know, it's kind of like an interesting space to navigate, because there are cultural expectations, and like as an artist in the world, you want to be able to like stand as an artist in the world, not because like you're in this box or you're in that box, or you should be doing this or your art should be doing that. You know, like your art should be saving children. It's like, well, maybe it will, maybe it won't. And so like to find value for yourself as an artist and not have it be kind of ascribed to these, you know, social things that women traditionally are supposed to do is kind of an interesting thing for me. I mean, that's a lot of times I'm kind of confronting that in my work, you know, mm-hmm. like what the expectation is of a woman artist and like what your work should do. And like, you know, and also like how you should be with other artists and like what your place is in the community. And like, you know, this element of selflessness. And those are like all these kind of hidden expectations that are tied in to being a woman artist that like I feel like I have to confront on a daily basis. And it's like sometimes I don't want to be selfless, and sometimes I don't want to save the world. You know, sometimes I just want to like express something that needs to be expressed, and it might not feed the homeless. So it's sort of an interesting conundrum. And while there's this kind of explosion of like talking about women's issues, I feel like in some respects, this kind of social practice thing is also kind of boxing people in into roles that are like expected. And I see like more and more that there's artist grants are geared towards social practice. And it's like, so essentially you're basically saying, if I'm not like somebody who's going to be working in, as this kind of mother figure as an artist, that there won't be funding for my work. And I feel like that's kind of unfair, because women have been locked out of funding for a long time as it is. And so it's like now if they're coming into their own and when I make work that's very self-centered, the funding won't be there for that. So yeah, it's just kind of a interesting time and place, I think, in navigating the art world. And especially if you're making work that's not like commercially viable, you know, that work that's like difficult, that's not going to sell in a commercial gallery, you really rely on these outside sources. And then once those outside sources start to tell you what kind of work you need to make in order to get the funding, suddenly you're like, wait a minute, you know? Yeah.
We are pretty close to time. Yeah. There's one last question that I always ask everybody before we close, yeah. And that is whether there's a piece of art or literature or just general creativity that you've experienced recently that meant something to you.
I think I, you know, every day I work in a museum, so I'm lucky like that. we have this amazing room of black and white Ellsworth Kelly paintings that are just like, I just go in there and they're magical. Every time I see them, the surface of the canvas showing through, the fact that there should be pure black and pure white and they're not, the shapes, at times they strike me as very human and other times as like something else. Yeah, like I keep going into one painting and it keeps looking like a breast to me, but then it's obviously it's just a geometric shape. So there's this really kind of beautiful thing that's happening between like organic and formal. And I pass them by on my way to work. Like when I go to the elevator every day, and every day I see this painting, and it's like a new experience every morning. Mm. So that's pretty magical.
Great. Well, hey, I really appreciate you taking the time and talking with me. I had a great time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. I appreciate it.
Okay, so as I mentioned at the top of the show, if you would like to see Justina's work in person, her solo exhibition of Land of Epic Battles is at Lightwork in the Kathleen O. Ellis Gallery through March 2nd. That's in Syracuse, New York. And then she also has work in a group exhibition at Haverford College in Haverford, Pennsylvania through April 29th. And you can find links to both of those in the show notes. And that is our show. If you'd like to get in touch, you can find all of the show's contact and social media info in the show notes. If you'd like to support the show, a monthly pledge in any amount to our Patreon campaign is greatly appreciated. You can find that at patreon.com/sake river. That's sake like the drink and river like river. Our theme music is by Poddington Bear. You can find more of his music available for licensing at soundofpicture.com. We will be back on February 28th with a conversation with photographer Brenda Biondo, so be sure to come back for that one. And until then, remember, keep the channel open.